How do you convince a group of high school students to endure physical pain, mental fatigue, awkward silences, and the threat of death? How do you do it? Well, show them something like this, if we have it. Did we get that picture? Oh, we didn't get it? Oh, okay, I'm gonna have to paint the picture for you. Here we go. It's the image of Half Dome from Glacier Point. If you've ever been there, you know it. You're standing at Glacier Point, which is where they used to do the firefall thing. Some of you may have seen that. I wasn't alive when they did it. I could never have seen that, and I wish I could. But you're standing here, and you're looking at Half Dome in the distance. Half Dome is this giant rock jutting up from the landscape that's half missing. So it comes up in a curve, and then straight down. And you see it from the distance, and it's beautiful. And then you can get a high school student to start a hike to go there. It's not too hard. But it takes a little bit of effort to get to the next view, which is at the top of the dome, looking out at the entire valley. Because the summit view is a wee bit more profound than the one from Glacier Point. We've always begun our spiel when I would lead this group of students. They were all high school seniors. We'd begin our spiel to them with this. To everyone else, all of your friends back home, this is just a Wednesday. But to you, this is the day you conquer Half Dome. And then go, yeah! Woo! And then I'd be the buzzkill, because you have to do that. You can't get kids too foamy at the mouth, because then they start running off the cliffs, you know, that kind of stuff. It's not good. So then we do the safety spiel. We say, okay, but you got to stay on the paths, the well-worn paths. Follow your guide. Do what he or she tells you. And don't argue. Right? And number three, I was going to say don't die. Number three, keep hiking. Don't stop hiking. We will take breaks, but don't stop on your own. That's not good. The sun sets, it gets dangerous. We could tell them, if you die, you get to see Jesus, but if you die, we have to see your parents. That's not fun. We had one student one year who used photography as a means. She told me later she did this, so I know why she did it. She used photography as a means to take breaks along the way because her muscles were burning. So she'd stop and take pictures and take a little rest, but not really tell me. Oh, taking pictures. I said, you gotta move. We can't take this many breaks. She said, Pastor Ryan, before we left this place, you told us this was God's creation. And I'm enjoying God's creation. I'm soaking it all in. And I said, and I had a real profound, this was not the joke, I had a profound sense of death. I'm leading a group of students. I said, when the sun sets, there's a real danger of death on the trail in Yosemite. You can soak in God's creation when you're alive. You can't do it when you're dead. Keep hiking. And she did. And we made it to the top and back before sunset. Keep hiking. Our fourth reading for today is from John chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. It's the story of Jesus turning water into wine. And it's the story of, much like the story of Yosemite, from the top, or a party, a wedding party, to then the wine giving out. And there being a lack. Much like when you're hiking in Yosemite and you're in the valley and it hurts and it's hot and there's incense. To finally summoning the top of the peak. Just like when Jesus turns the water into wine and keeps the party going. If you hate mixed metaphors, you're going to hate this sermon. Some of you are already thinking it. But stick with me. So listen to and for the word of God. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? My hour has not yet come." That's a way to talk to your mom. His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. This passage is so deep and so rich and so full, I couldn't possibly cover it all. From Old Covenant language to New Covenant language, even the very fact it starts with the words, "on the third day, alone." I mean, you can go down this, just have a study on this, okay? I'm not going to be able to preach on all of it. I really do want to touch on this idea of starting at this beautiful celebration place, descending into the valley and summiting again. So with that in mind, let's begin. This passage this morning tells the story of a celebration in Cana of Galilee, 10 miles northeast maybe of Nazareth. We can imagine there were many more there celebrating. We know that Jesus was there, his disciples, his mother. The story reveals a real miracle. I want to let you know this. I firmly believe this was a real miracle. It's not a metaphor, but it does speak about our lives today. It talks about God's real power over creation and Jesus showing that and demonstrating that. But it really does for us today speak to our comings and our goings. So what does it have to do with us today? Well, it all started with a celebration. Just like the first view of the dome when you get it all in, or when the wedding party first starts, that first initial celebration. Do you know those seasons? Good seasons. Great seasons. When you're recognized for your gifts, for your accomplishments, when you're surrounded with friends. Okay, I'm very relational, so some of you are like, "Yeah, that's not me." How about when you're accomplishing or crushing your goals? When your ledger is, and your financial solvency, you're in the black. Some of you love that. You're like, "Yeah, that's a great season." Right? What about that season? Isn't it a great season? It's a beautiful season. But here's the thing. The wine gives out. It doesn't last. It never does. Whether it's personal, spiritual, public, communal, ecclesial, the wine will give out. And this is what we see here. The wine gives out. The yearly reviews from your employer are not always so gleaming. Your family is not always not fighting. Your team falls on hard times and fires its coach and then fires its replacement. It's not always a good season. It's not always a good time. The wine gives out. The circumstances that surround us are not always good news. And that's when the wine gives out. And it happens every time. The party's over. It was a good run. But it's all done. In the book Spirituality of the Psalms, theologian, author, and poet Walter Brueggemann writes about this phenomenon in our life. But realizes that it's not just something that happens in our lives as a phenomenon. It was written even into Scripture. In the Psalms, even, we see three different kinds of Psalms using this way of seeing life. psalms of orientation, places that orient you to the truth of who God is. Psalms of disorientation, psalms that really have you walking through the valley, where David walked through the valley, where David even cries out for God. Why have you forsaken me, David says. And then psalms of reorientation, psalms where that first orientation went through a process of disorientation to now see God in a new way, in a new light, as God would reveal God's self, not as we fantasize about God. And these psalms walk us through over and over what happens in our lives from the day we're born. This morning, if you get anything out of what I say today, I would love for you to hear this. After the wine gives out, whether it be sulking or sorrow, God wants us to move into a new celebration. And it doesn't happen like this, but God is calling us into a new celebration. You see, just as we see in this passage, Jesus will make new wine for a new party that we are beckoned into for a new future. How do we do that? Let's look at Mary, Jesus' mother. I think she has a beautiful picture of three paths, just like hiking on the trail, three paths, one or more of which you can go down to get to a place where the new wine flows. But it all started with faith. Mary's faith in Jesus led her down these paths. And so let's begin there with Mary's faith. That's what led her down to take these paths, to go down these roads. It wasn't a desire to change things. She wasn't trying to fix. She had faith. She went to Jesus. Jesus, they have no wine. Her first path was naming the truth. Path number one, name the truth. It can be so hard to name the truth, because sometimes it hurts. Some people are better at it than others. Some people are really bad at naming the truth, even though they really think they're good at it. I'm one of those people sometimes. And some people are just so good at naming the truth, but you gotta name the truth when you're in a season of disorientation. But here's the thing. When everyone just tries to name the truth, I'll tell you what the problem is. Here's the problem. I know what the problem is. We gotta do this. Everyone has different problems, you know. No one ever comes and says the same thing. Everyone has different ways. How do you get beyond that? Fuller professor and change leader, Scott Cormode, tells a story. He was a consultant for a denomination, and they were going through struggle, conflict. There were two sides. One side saw the truth this way. The other side saw the truth this way. What do you do? Well, usually one side wins out, or you split equally, you go your separate ways, you never talk again. That's not the path that they took. Scott Cormode took them for a two-day retreat where they needed to accomplish one task for the weekend. What was that? All they needed to do was name the truth that their opponent said was the truth. They just had to name what the opponent said, but not name it and then throw a little snarky comment at the end. And not name it and leave out the part that was actually showed that your opponent actually had a heart after all, right? The stuff that we usually do is leave out the good parts of our opponent's argument because we're trying to like bash it. They had to name their opponent's truth so that the opponent said, yes, that's it. You're right. That's what I believe. It's hard to do. And it took them two full days to do it. And they did it. What happened? Here's the interesting thing. No one changed their mind. No one said, oh, you're right, let's all do the same thing. We all see the same truth the same way. We're all going to now change our points of view and do this. They actually didn't. You're like, so what's the point? Because they stopped making the truth that they saw wedges between them. They saw that the other person was a human. They saw that they cared and loved. They saw that they had a heart. They saw that they were believers. And they continued to worship with those people, even though they disagreed. Name the truth. Name the other person's truth. Path number one. Path number two. Do whatever he tells you. Now, I'm not saying me. Whatever Pastor Ryan or Pastor Steve says, do whatever he tells you. That's not it. I'm talking going back to this. Do whatever he tells you. What does that mean? What did Jesus tell us? There are some things that are really easy for you to live out. Right? Some things that you're really naturally gifted at doing that Jesus says. Not everything he said was really hard, right? My yoke is easy, my burden is light. There's a lot of things that you can do because you're gifted in a certain way and you're like, I can do that. I'm good with money. I can take care of that. I can be a good steward. I can be generous. I can love people. I can be merciful. Some people have these gifts. But then there are some things that Jesus says. And if you're kidding, if you think everything is easy that Jesus says, or I do it all, I already do it. We know, right? You haven't read the whole Bible then. You haven't read of what all Jesus said. There's really hard stuff in there. There's really confusing stuff in there. Jesus doesn't make it easy for us to do everything. But he's always there with us as we do. So do whatever he tells you. Start with the easy stuff, the stuff you're gifted at. Do that and do it well and celebrate. Yeah, woo, this is great. Then take some of the hard stuff. Try to do some of those things. Wrestle with it. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy to love your enemy. Who can do that? It's not going to be easy to, when someone makes you carry their armor 1 mile, go an extra mile. Can't do that. That's hard. But that's what Jesus says. Do whatever he tells you. That's path number two. And as we all do that together, we start to experience that God will call us to do some crazy stuff, but it's God calling us to it to show us his grace, his mercy, his new future, his new hope. Path number three. This is the craziest part, and this is the crazy stuff to which I refer. In this story, Jesus tells these stewards, these servants, excuse me, put water into these 6 stone jars for Jewish rite of purification. It's not meant to hold wine, friends. Those jars were not meant to hold wine. They're meant for a purpose. They're sacred. You don't mess with that. You don't put wine in the jars meant for the rite of purification. You don't do it. That's wrong. But Jesus does it. This could be the hardest of all the pathways. To allow the sacred vessels in your life, whatever those 6 stone jars are for you, to allow them to be repurposed for what God has for them. That's hard. That's not easy. But they could be anything. It could be, you know, a voice from the past, maybe a loved one, a relative who died, who said, this is the way the world is. And you're like, okay, I'm always going to follow what that person says because they are always right, because they're always here. And if they were alive, they'd be probably tell you, no, it's okay. You can do it. You can do it. It's okay. It's fine. But because it was their voice and it was from the past, I'm never going to change. I've had a lot of people do that. I've done it. It could be literally a physical thing. I took ordination vows on the, not ordination vows, I took ordination tests on the font You know, could you put in there a different kind of thing other than water, right, to do this? I'm not going to say yes. I'm going to tell you no, it should be water. It should be water. But the thing is, we have so many sacred vessels. You cannot do anything. I've had kids running through a sanctuary and say, you cannot run in the sanctuary. But then the kids want to come back to the sanctuary because they played hide and go seek in the sanctuary once and they loved it. And they come back. But there are sacred vessels needing to be repurposed. There's a story that Grady Parsons, our former stated clerk of the Peace USA, he tells in his book, The Connectional Church. One of the stories is of a church in Tennessee. What's the storyline? We have church on Sunday, you come to us. You come to us on Sunday, you come in our doors, right? What did they do? Well, they were down to 14 people. They went out to the soccer fields and cheered at soccer games. That dreaded thing tearing apart the church, youth sports. And they actually went and cheered for these kids that they didn't even know. That's one of their grandkids. They went and cheered for them, and they had shirts that said Spring City Presbyterian, and they went out there so people saw them. And then more and more people got to know their heart. They didn't get to say, ooh, this is a cool group of people. No, they were like all like older people. They weren't trying to be cool. They were trying to love people. And now their church is tripled. That's not the point, though. The point is how they allowed their sacred vessel of how they saw church and how they do church together. They allowed it to be repurposed. And what a change it was. First path. The first path is to name the truth and then name the other person's truth. Second path is to do whatever he tells you. Start with the easy, go to the hard. And the third path is to allow your sacred vessel to be repurposed. Friends, this is what is needed in a world shattered by political fights and violent exchanges. This is what's needed for faith in a time when it seems that people say faith is outdated. It's what's needed for a Christian church, a church that's shrinking here in America. It actually is all across the board. There's no one denomination. No, it's actually all shrinking pretty much. Little by little, kind of goes up and down in different spots. But you know what's happening in the world today, friends? It is growing like wildfire. Spreading like wildfire. Talk about mixed metaphors. It's spreading like wildfire, the church. It is growing like crazy in the global south. Not here in America, but it's growing in the global south. Can we rejoice in that? And can we have hearts open to what they may be doing? Can we invite a missionary from their land to come here so that we can experience the new wine that God has and enjoy it? Enjoy that new wine for the new party, the new celebration, that makes the old one look like cheap wine. That's what God calls us into. And it's about faith. That's all it takes. It takes faith to name the truth. It takes faith to do whatever he tells you. And it takes faith to repurpose your sacred vessels. And that's a gift of God. And when that happens, water can be turned into wine. The celebration can be reborn, and people will believe in Jesus because the view from the top of Half Dome is way better than the one from Glacier Point. Takes faith to get there, though. Keep hiking. Keep hiking. Amen.